Obstructive lung diseases. Let's see about the other obstructive lung diseases. First is chronic bronchitis. Here, there's persistent cough with sputum production for at least 3 months in at least 2 consecutive years. This is the definition of chronic bronchitis. Persistent cough with sputum production for at least 3 months in 2 consecutive years. This may accelerate decline in lung function and it can lead to cor pulmonale and heart failure. Cor pulmonale is right-sided heart failure due to lung disease and it can cause atypical metaplasia and dysplasia of the respiratory epithelium, which can lead to cancer transformation. The patients with chronic bronchitis are called as blue bloaters as they develop mild cyanosis due to hypercapnia, hypoxemia and dyspnea. Pathogenesis of chronic bronchitis. The initiating factor is exposure to irritating inhalants like tobacco smoke or dust from grains, cotton and silica. This leads to 3 pathogenesis. First is mucus hypersecretion, which is the earliest feature. Second is inflammation and third is infection. The mucus hypersecretion is associated with hypertrophy of submucosal glands in trachea and bronchi. And there's release of inflammatory mediators like interleukin-13 and histamine. And there is increase in number of goblet cells in small airways, which also contributes to airway obstruction. This is about mucus hypersecretion. Next, coming to inflammation. Inflammation causes cellular damage and activation of acute and chronic inflammatory response, which involves neutrophils, lymphocytes and macrophages. The long-standing inflammation with fibrosis of small airways leads to chronic airway obstruction. Third is infection. Infection is not an initiating factor, but it is significant in maintaining the infection and is critical in producing acute exacerbations. This is about the pathogenesis of chronic bronchitis. So when there is cigarette smoking, this leads to damage of airway lining cells leading to chronic inflammation, and also it interferes with the ciliary action of respiratory epithelium. So it prevents mucus clearance and thereby increases the risk of infection. These two lead to chronic bronchitis. Next, the morphology. Grossly, there is hyperemia, swelling and edema of mucous membranes with excessive mucopurulent secretions. So there is hyperemia, swelling and edema of mucous membranes with excessive mucopurulent secretions. Next, microscopically, there is epithelial hyperplasia and the main cell is mucus cell. And the bronchial epithelium shows squamous metaplasia or dysplasia. So there's mucus cell hyperplasia and the bronchial epithelium shows squamous metaplasia or dysplasia. And the Reid's index in case of chronic bronchitis is more than 0.4. This is characteristic for chronic bronchitis. What is Reid's index? Reid's index is the ratio of thickness of the mucus gland layer to the thickness of the wall between the epithelium and cartilage. So in this picture, B is the thickness of mucus gland layer and A plus B plus C. This is the thickness of wall between the epithelium and the cartilage. This is the epithelium and the cartilage. So Reid's index is B divided by A plus B plus C. which is more than 0.4 in case of chronic bronchitis. Normal is equal to 0.4. In severe cases of chronic bronchitis, there is obliteration of the lumen due to fibrosis. This condition is called bronchiolitis obliterans. Clinical features of chronic bronchitis. The characteristic feature is presence of persistent cough along with sparse sputum production. Eventually, there is dyspnea on exertion. With continued smoking, there is hypercapnia, hypoxemia and mild cyanosis, due to which the patients are called as blue bloaters. Next, long-standing severe chronic bronchitis can lead to cor pulmonale, that is right-sided heart failure due to lung etiology, and cardiac failure. The next obstructive lung disease is bronchiectasis. This is a disorder in which there is permanent dilation of bronchi and bronchioles. This is due to destruction of smooth muscle and elastic fibers by chronic necrotizing infections. There is permanent dilation of bronchi and bronchioles due to destruction of smooth muscles and elastic fibers by chronic necrotizing infections. Causes of bronchiectasis. Congenital conditions like cystic fibrosis, immunodeficiency states and cartilaginous syndrome. Infectious causes include the necrotizing pneumonia caused by bacteria, virus and fungi. Third is bronchial obstruction due to tumor, foreign bodies or mucus impaction. Other causes include rheumatoid arthritis, systemic lupus erythematosus, inflammatory bowel disease, chronic obstructive pulmonary disease and post-transplantation, that is graft versus host disease caused due to post-transplantation. In 1/4 to half of the cases, the cause is idiopathic, that is the cause is unknown. The pathogenesis of bronchiectasis. Main causes are obstruction and infection. The obstruction causes impairment of normal clearing mechanisms. So there is pooling of secretions distal to the obstruction. This leads to secondary infection and inflammation. This is the obstructive pathogenesis. Next is infection of the bronchi. When the infection is severe, it leads to inflammation with necrosis and fibrosis, which leads to dilation of the airway. So the main pathogenesis are obstruction and infection of the bronchi. Next is primary ciliary dyskinesia. That is, when there is ciliary dysfunction due to mutation of dynein gene. This condition is called as primary ciliary dyskinesia. There is retention of secretions and recurrent infections due to retention of secretions. This leads to bronchiectasis. So next pathogenesis is primary ciliary dyskinesia. Morphology. Morphology of bronchiectasis. The bronchiectasis usually affects the lower lobes bilaterally, that is both sides of the lower lobes. It is more severe when the distal bronchi and bronchioles are involved. The airways are dilated sometimes up to 4 times the normal size. In the cut section of the lung, there are dilated bronchi which are cystic and filled with mucopurulent secretions. So the airways are dilated and the cut surface shows dilated bronchi which are cystic, which are filled with mucopurulent secretions. Next, microscopy. of full-blown active case of bronchiectasis. There is intense, acute and chronic inflammatory exudation within the walls of bronchi and bronchioles, and there is desquamation of epithelium along with extensive areas of ulceration. So microscopically, there is intense, acute and chronic inflammatory exudation within the walls of bronchi and bronchioles along with desquamation of epithelium and extensive areas of ulceration. The bacteria found in case of bronchiectasis are staphylococci, streptococci, pneumococci, enteric organisms, anaerobic and microaerophilic bacteria. And in children, the bacteria found are Haemophilus influenzae and Pseudomonas aeruginosa. The clinical course in case of bronchiectasis. There is severe and persistent cough with expectoration of foul smelling, sometimes bloody sputum. And there is dyspnea and orthopnea in severe cases. There is severe persistent cough with expectoration of foul smelling and bloody sputum. And there is dyspnea and orthopnea in severe cases. Occasionally, there can be massive hemoptysis. That is coughing of blood. The symptoms are episodic. They are precipitated by upper respiratory tract infections. There can occur paroxysms of cough at the morning. This is because the change in position causes collection of pus and secretions to drain into the bronchi. So there can be paroxysms of cough when he wakes up in the morning. Next, there is obstructive respiratory insufficiency, which can lead to dyspnea and cyanosis. Due to cyanosis, the patients are called as blue bloaters. Next is treatment of bronchiectasis. This is done by giving better antibiotics and by physical therapy. This is about bronchiectasis. And we'll see about the last obstructive lung disease, that is asthma, in the next video. Thank you.